before, we just have participants. So here, the idea was just to increase, to make the same, to have the same ID, so to increase the length, the size of your sample, and to see what's happening. And you see that when you increase the size of the sample, you are going near the theta parameter that you want to estimate. So it's, the consistency is, you can see it on this graph. So here, I give you all the elements for the course of joint. Now, we have to finish together with the Kernel-Kursky estimator. So the idea is, in fact, just to open the program that I gave you for the first lines, and I want you to copy the first lines, and then to calculate, to compute the Kernel-Kursky estimator. So just have a look at the beginning and don't and forget the following. I show you what I want you to see. So the last is the kernel. Okay. So in fact, I want you to stop here. Just here. And you can have a look on the website, but to finish before KDE and simulation. Okay, so you can have a look at it. Is it on the website? No?
No.
No?
Okay.
Ah, okay. The bias. I asked for, but... Okay, maybe if you have some USB. Yes, I think the best. But yes, I sent an email this morning to put it on the website. And the two others. So the first idea. Thank you. The idea here is to compute a mix of distribution, mixing distribution. So you will consider here that we have in fact 1/3 of the distribution which comes from this normal distribution and the two other. The 2/3 parts which come from this one. Okay, so it's a mixed distribution, and if you have a look on the, if you want to know the density function of this. So if you want to know the distribution of your sample, in fact, you just have to calculate this one. So the first one is the second condition. So the idea is not not computed. So imagine that I have computed the first one. Imagine that this one is a sample from the distribution, from this distribution. And that imagine that now N2 is issuing from this. If you want to have to obtain your simulations, be careful to do that. It's false. If you do that, in fact, you are just doing an array of two random variables, but it's not a mixed solution. So it's not. Don't need you have to do. And what you have to do is, in fact, to select one third simulation from this sample, and two thirds of the sample issuing from the second simulation. Okay, it's a mix. So when you write this distribution, be careful. You don't. If you make a simulation, you need not to add and not to average. Have two random variables, you have to select one third of the sample issuing from the first sample and the second and the two other thirds issuing from the second. Okay. So Et si on s'envoie, je suis un tueur carnel.
In fact, t is just here the number of values that you consider.
in that world. You can see that I will select the first normal distribution, which name is N1. It's the distribution with a mean of minus 5 and the standard deviation equal to 1. And you see that in fact I simulate the same size. So what I'm doing here, in fact, I don't, if you have one onward value, you could consider that in fact you have maybe 33 for the first distribution and 67 for the second one. But my idea was not this one. I have simulated here my first random variable, so with the first normal distribution, then the second one. And I have simulated also a uniform between 0 and 1. And I have considered here this variable. The fact that the uniform distribution from between 0 and 1 is lower than 1 over 3. Maybe I can ask them to put the file on the website to find it. Who's going to give?
Yes, the
okay, everybody has the program?
Yes.
Okay.
The first one, if
have a 1 and the second one if this vector is equal to 0. You can do a other thing. What is, yes, it's a simulation which is correct. Okay? So you can have a look at the program. Here, my P variable is equal to my first, if it was a simulation of my first Gaussian distribution with one other value. Here, N2 is the simulation for my second Gaussian distribution. And Xj, my sample, is equal to my uniform here. Produce. So I will take N1 if u is equal to 1, and I will take N2 if u is equal to 0. One way to see you. So, after that, you have here this function, is in fact the density function. You can rename it. This is a density function of, you know it now, but the end is just to see if that your KDE is near from the real distribution function that you want. And the real distribution function is this one. In fact, the distribution, in fact, the density function of, it was the first one that I wrote. The mix of the two distribution functions. So now you have all the elements, and the question is, can you obtain using the KDE, can you obtain back your estimation, and to see the impact of the bandwidth. So you have to program it, to compute it, but you have to consider that in this problem, I write again this one. If I use J to be sure, it's the same. So here, in fact, if you want to calculate your KDE, you have to consider that you have your sample. Well, sample. That you have your axis value to calculate your KDE. And the question is, and you know that this function. And call it KDE. KDE depends on the value that on which you, where you want to calculate the KDE estimator. So it depends on X. So this vector we can call it X, and this one in the program we call it XJ. So it depends on X. The points where you calculate your KDE. It's not a variable, it's not a random variable, it's just the axis. That is not. Here you have here the X, here you have your sample. And you depend also on the bandwidth, which is H, and the kernel, which is K. And you can use the kernel k, and you can say that the kernel k in one case maybe be uniform, maybe be vanish meter, so you can change the name of the kernel if you take it into account as a variable. Okay. try to estimate, even if you don't do a function for the moment, I have a solution. I will provide you a solution, but the idea is just to be sure that you have understood, in fact, the calculations that that is made by using a KT. So the difference between, it's in fact a local estimation. So considering one point, one axis point, I will change the calculation because I will not take into account the same points in the same one. And if you have a look on the maximum likelihood estimation, when you are doing a maximum likelihood estimation, in fact you are estimating all the samples at the same point. And you give the same point. You don't have to change, you don't have to estimate locality. In fact, you only need to consider that you only need to estimate your parameters, and if you have your parameters, in fact you know the density function everywhere. Here, you don't know it everywhere. So if I calculate it on one point, I don't know the density function for the next one. So I have to calculate it every time. So that can so make, what you can do is to compute just the kernel function, the four kernel function, to compute the beginning of this. Here, this one, and then we see after, and then to calculate the kernel estimate. And you will have the solution on one. uniform. So here in red you have the uniform carrier. In green you have the triangular carrier. In blue you have your ocean carrier. And here in black you have your foundation curve carrier. Okay, so you see that the weight, so you have to consider here that I have the x point and I want to calculate the density function in this one. So I have to make some weights to the sample in the neighborhood of my point. And you see that the weights are not the same. In fact, here you give a uniform weight and you stop. With the triangular, it was the same, but it's not a uniform one. And the question one doesn't stop, you have to be weight. But you see that the majority of people, the majority of samples are just in the neighborhood also. So you see here that the weight functions are very different. What you will see after, I can say you that from a theoretical point of view, you don't have a lot of differences between the kernel. So the choice of kernel is not an important point. And you will see that from a practical point of view, there is no so much, there is no so many differences between the four kernels. But the model is very important.
But most of the software use the first one.
Yes, yes, for this demonstration, yes, and for this demonstration I use the first one. So it's just a choice.
Yes.
The first one. But it doesn't matter. The only one that I prefer not to consider is the uniform one. Because the uniform one you see that you don't give you give the same weight. So I prefer to I prefer to give the most important weight if I'm really near from my point and to decrease after. But except this one is not a bad one. See that from a surgical point of view it's not a bad one, but from a smoothing point of view, I prefer to use some other counts, some more with more smoothness.
No, it's not. find the best color function.
It's not the question that find the best color function, but here we have the real one and then we use the different color error for the distribution. But then we use the color error, how we find the true distribution.
I will show you all the graphics now, and I want you to move it up, but just to explain that what it is. So, here for example, so, let's have a look on this one. So here is for depression of time. Okay, probably I have some four plots for the definition of Pian. And you see that I have changed the form width. I don't know for the answer for optimal ones. I have tried four points. The first one is 1/10. And you see that, in fact, you see that the red curve, which is the KD, you see that the red curve has a lot of variations. Do you agree? You see that you have a lot of variations, but you see that in a wedge, you are not so bad. The average of the red one is near from the blue one. Just an illustration here that you have a bias, which is not, but the variance, which is very far. And we saw yesterday that if you choose a small one, in fact you will obtain a large bias and a big bias. So it's just an illustration. But the question, I will come back to the notion of large bias, a big or a small bias. It depends on your sample, in fact. But for the moment, 1/10. And if I continue, it's 1/2. Here you see that, okay, the bias seems to be not so bad, and the variance is less important than before. The question is that you don't use the blue one, you don't use the real density function to estimate, of course, the KD. It's just here a simulation, you can compare. You have simulated your sample, you know the distribution, but in fact you just use some simulations, and based on your simulations, you calculate your density estimator. So you can compare the density estimator that you obtain with the real density function that you don't know in general. But here it was just to have a comparison. But you don't, to calculate your kernel density estimator, here you don't use, of course, the density function. So you see that if you increase, in fact, the bandwidth, your variance is decreasing, but the bias is increasing. And the worst case for the bias is here. You see that the difference between the two functions that you don't know and your estimation, okay, you have a very a lower variance estimator, very biased estimator. So the question is, if you do it by choosing it's not a good choice. Not a good choice. Because you don't know how to choose the choice. The question is how I can calibrate, in fact. So what we use in practice, we use the cross-validation criterion that we saw yesterday. So the question is, in fact, you have to calculate this cross-validation criterion. So if I remember correctly, it was here. You have to calculate first this integration and then back integration. 12 minutes. I just have to check, but I think it was the first edition that I used yesterday. So what you can do to choose a novice, in fact you can compute, you can choose the first novice and to calculate the cost variation together. So here it's possible to calculate it. You can calculate your KDE. So you can regress and do it. You can integrate your KDE also. You can use a numerical approximation. Point angular, turn angular, what you want. And I do it for performance. And then I just choose the bonus with the minimum of the cross variation criterion. And the cross variation criterion, you remember it was mean square. It was in fact the mean square error. And the mean square error is the sum of the variance and the bias square. So in fact you are choosing the best compromise between bias and bias.
Okay.
So when we obtain it, so now it's possible to calculate your correlation choice. So here I show you the correlation criterion for different models. So I compute here the plot. And you can see that in fact you obtain the minimum here. And so you choose, in this case, this bonus. Because it's a bonus which minimizes your cross-variation there. And when you compute this one, you obtain this case. So you see that your first real function was a blue one, and the estimated function is a red one. With 100 values. So you have not a so big example. 100 is could be a big example if you have a parametric model. Because when you use maximum value, it's enough to calculate some average. But for a local estimation, you see that it's not so bad. You only have 100 points here and you are able not to be so far from the real constitution. And if you increase what you can do also, if you increase the sample size, you will see that in fact you are better and better off. So the idea here, I just chose first 100 sample size, but you can increase, you can modify, of course, the point, the main point. And you can try other samples. So, and now, what you can do also is to do the same, but for the 4 kernel. So here, I have considered the 4 kernel, and I have estimated the 4 optimal bandwidths for each kernel. So you see that here, the optimal bandwidths are not the same. They are not so far from Kepanishnikov and normal, but triangular and uniform are far from this. So the question is not to find the best bandwidth, but the question is to find the best bandwidth for a given kernel. Answer your question?
Yes.
I don't forget. But yes, we have to do all these things before choosing the kernel. You see that in fact you don't have a lot of difference between the four kernels. Just the smoothness. Only the smoothness is different. But the differences between the four kernel and the real utility function are not so big. The first one and the second one, if you see some differences, yes of course you see some differences, but to know if I prefer this one or this one, not sure. It's not so easy. The only one that I don't like, general, it's a uniform one. Because the uniform one, you have some stairs. But if you compare the differences between the red one and the blue one, it's not so bad. So if you don't consider the smoothness of your estimation, you can consider that the uniform one is the correct one. So in general, what we choose is mainly the Gaussian one or the evanishing curve. Both are really good. And now in a lot of computing, you have a function which is, so you can find in R or in other computational software, you can find in general a density function. And what's the density function? Density function is just the estimation of what we have done. So now what I want you to do is calculate to compute the cadence estimator to be sure that you can calculate it. You understand what's happening with this estimation. So you have all the work, I know, but I want you to, be sure that it's clear. change the name, the size of the sample. One component. Here I can change and take one word or five components. The more important size, sample size, the cross-validation calculations are longer. But you have to, because you have to compute more and more calculations. But it's not a problem, you can use it in a so one word is enough to see what's happening.
So we have a constitution from
So the question is, can you calculate also the density function? And the problem is that the point x, you can write it. You can write that your point x is x1, xp. And it's for you. So, in fact, the solution of your theorem is this one. You can write it as we wrote before. The solution is one dimension. So you will define here n, h, but h over p.
You are taking a multidimensional Gaussian kernel
of multidimensional Epanishnikov, in fact, the produce of Epanishnikov canal or the produce of Gaussian canal. So if you want to consider the estimation in multidimensional for multidimensional variables, non-dependent variables, you can use this. But the curse of dimensionality is increasing. I told you yesterday that you are doing a local estimation. So you need points to estimate, of course, your density function. So imagine now that if I am in one dimension and that I open a bandwidth, my bandwidth is something like this. So I need to find points inside. In dimension 2. Yeah, something like that. So I have to find more and more in dimension. When I share my space, I have more and more elements in which I want to find some neighborhood. So you will find more and more local points where there is no sample points. So no way to estimate your density function when you have no points. So more you increase your dimension, more you need that. And generally you don't have so many data. So in one dimension, really okay to estimate, to use the density estimation with the kernel method. But when you increase the dimension, another point. So you can use it in one dimension and in multidimensional, you need to have really many, many points to be able to estimate. In fact, you should consider here that you can share. You want to estimate. If you put 100 points here or just 100 points here, it's easier here than here. Because here you will find some. The points are not everywhere. So here, and when you increase the dimension, you will apply dimension 3, of course, and you can increase the dimension, but you will have the same. But sometimes it would be interesting to have some such estimation to have a link between variables. For example, for meteorological variables, if you want to use the links between the distribution of the temperature, the humidity, and the wind speed, just want to have a risk of calculation, it would be a nice point. But in general, you don't have enough data to use. So sometimes you use some copulous method to estimate the link between functions. It's another way.
And when we
orbit
one person up to three, is it not that every row?
Yes.
Well, why is it going to be?
Yes, yes. Yes.
How can you integrate without the problem?
Okay, when you are in a multidimensional, for example, if you, in general you are for a density function, if you just want to consider the density function, it's not so you don't have a lot of cases in practice when you want to consider just consider the density function in a multidimensional case. So, so you can maybe what you can do is to make some plots to consider some. Just reduce your dimension and consider the two first variables or the one variable one and the third one. Like when you are doing a component principal analysis, in general, you are reducing the dimension, and even if you have a dimension of 3 or 4, you need to, in fact, to represent, to plot different points. So it's the same here. If you have a multidimensional density function, you have to project it and to have a look on different functions. But it's, yes, it's a way of reducing and to have a look on your selection. But in general, what you can obtain, in fact, is the main point where you find the dimension point is for regression. When you want to estimate a new function between variable and some covariates. So the covariates are, in fact, are the dimension of your problem. And when you have a linear regression model, you can find easily the mean function. But when you have a non-parametric estimation like this, with a kernel method, which are you don't see the mean function, because the function is too important. But what you can see, in fact, is the mean square error. So, to have a look if is it a correct method or not, in general we have a look on the results and we make some cross-validation analysis to be sure that we have a good model to estimate and to forecast. Yes, it was just the solution. It's impossible. Okay. A non-parametric course, I think it needs auto. But join the I thought that we need 1 week to have a non-parametric. But it was just an equation. And I told them you don't want to take auto. No, it's a joke because it was not. It was not the first notice, it was just to add something with a link, a dual link with a joint course, but decision different perspective. But it's not, we won't have enough time to see all the results and to show you all the certain. But what I want to say to tell you is you can use it in practice. Oui. So it's not you have to understand what's in it, but you can really use it in practice. To have a look, when Johnny told you at the beginning, we consider that we have a statistic model, so we consider probability family, it could be a help to determine, to define. Find in fact the probabilistic family. So it's not so really. Thank you. So I finish it up some questions. Thank you very much.
The information you gave me, so I would like just to check with you that it is okay. And I have done no mistake with your name. In French, we said
Tominoscope.
But this is more than Tominoscope because there is also information, not only the picture. If you see a mistake in the name, because of course I do not know any words in the Vietnamese, so there is any mistake short. So after this is you, I remember that you are from Russian, and it is almost that coming. Yeah. After here is where you start. Yeah. You are also from Russian, but you didn't say anything about your career.
I studied about elementary statistics.
Only that?
I'm going to say my last name is Pat.
Yeah, I'm going to be sure. and plant proteins.
I do commit that.
So just let's have a question. Here, plus anywhere, yeah, you are here. I did not see your position. You are what? That's what you know, you are what?
The master in the university of that.
And what is position at this time?
It's a slot.
Sorry? That's what you know?
That's cool.
Teacher at high school, okay.
His first name is Rob also.
Sorry?
His first name is Rob.
Yeah, it can be.
No, I said second name was.
Okay, great. He just arrived to manage this. Here?
There's no I.
No I.
Mute?
No I.
Here?
No I.
Mute?
Yes.
Okay. And if there's nothing, you okay? Or just on your action? Okay. He's not here to make
it. Yeah, he's not here.
Okay. So it is correct, right?
Yes.
And Tron, you are here, yeah. Is it correct what is written?
Yes.
Okay. After that, there is. Yeah. Is it correct? Okay. You can see that the women are writing better than the men because of the less mistakes after the reading. Correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Is it correct? And that one?
Yes.
Yeah, yes. Okay. But you are not only lecturer, you are the head of high school.
Yeah.
You should write it.
Take a picture. Eric,